Good morning. They told me I can't tell a joke, but you know me. I do it because it loosens the crowd up a little bit. There was this guy, 68 years old, retired. He called the Social Security office up, wanted to come in and get his check. The lady said, come on down. It was 90 miles away from his home. So he drove all the way there. And when he got there, he went up to the lady and told him who he was. She said, let me see your license. Jesus, he goes, I left my license home. She said, you know, I really can't give you a check because that's the only way I'm going to prove, you know, that you're 68 years old. He goes, I can't drive all the way back 90 miles and come back again. She said, take off your shirt. He said, what? Take off your shirt. So he opened up his shirt, he took it off, and she says, you got white hair all over there. She goes, you're 68 years old. I'll give you the check. He signed it, took the check, went home. When he got in the house, his wife said, how'd it go? He said, would you believe I left the license home, but she told me to take my shirt off? She says, take your shirt off for what? I don't know, but she saw the hair on my chest was all white. She believed I was 68 years old. The wife said, you should have dropped your pants. You would have got a disability check. My ILA family, sisters and brothers of the International Longshore Association, thank you, thank you. I salute and recognize you first as American frontline heroes and Canada frontline heroes and Puerto Rico frontline heroes. And now, proud to note, the Bahamas frontline heroes. ILA, heroes one and all, to my fellow ILA Executive Board and the International Vice Presidents, to our national and international dock workers, labor family, the International Dock Workers Council, the International Transport Workers and Federation, to Willie Adams, my ILWU president and colleague, my brother, my friend, and to all his officers and members, to the families and the friends of the ILA longshore workers, thank you. I am filled with pride to be part of this ILA family. I am filled with pride to stand here before you and lead this great organization as your president. I am more certain today than ever the ILA is a force to be reckoned with. Welcome to our 56th International Convention. I cannot match the spirituality of the gospel choir and Benny Bryant, who delivered our opening prayer. But we assure my sisters and brothers that I am humbly joined with you in proclaiming our Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior and guiding light at this convention. The Almighty is our real convention chairman. The ILA always invites our Lord into every meeting we hold, whether it's a wage scale session or an international convention. We honor God and we honor country. History is being made at this convention as we welcome our newest ILA members from our newest country, the Bahamas. They join our delegation from the US, Puerto Rico, and Canada. We are putting real force and meaning into this international in our name, the International Longshore Association. I worked on containers and know a little something about repairing them. But I never imagined I'd be delivered to the convention in one. What an honor to be once again brought into the convention hall, led by the mighty New York City Police Emerald Pipes and Drums, and to be also surrounded by special forces. Joining the police pipe band as my escort is Brian Porter, my friend and former member of the Sparta Police, who now is one of us, ILA. And what father would not be proud to be introduced to you by his oldest son, Dennis Daggett. Dennis, I want to maintain the energy level that you have generated getting us started this morning. Before I begin my remarks to you this morning, we have put together a powerful video review of our past 4 years titled The State of the Union that I would like you to see. Let's show the video.
ILA brothers and sisters, welcome to South Florida. When we last gathered here 4 years ago in 2019, nobody could have predicted what our industry and the entire world would face in March 2020.
The most serious health crisis in a century.
Japan has now seen a big spike in cases. They've declared a state of national emergency.
What about hospitals? Because I know the CDC is advising Americans to be prepared for significant disruption to their lives.
And New York is opening a handful of new testing sites.
New Jersey is a corridor state. So much of what we need, whether it be medical supplies or groceries, wouldn't get to us if it were not for these brave folks working in our ports at the International Longshoremen's Association.
Along with doctors, nurses, police, and firefighters, you, the women and men of the ILA, were America's frontline heroes in a global pandemic. You kept America's commerce moving and our economy alive.
It was a very serious time in the nation. Nurses were on the front line, doctors were on the front line, and my members were on the front line. And when I say the front line, I'm talking about commerce. What comes into this country and what goes out of this country. And if my men don't go to work, and they stay home because of the virus, this country shuts down.
It was probably the greatest accomplishment that the ILA could have ever done. So many people were dying, but yet our members still came out every day and made sure that the whole East Coast of the country was able to get through this. It was a tremendous endeavor on their part, and I'm so proud of this whole ILA. And as a member of the ILA for 58 years, I don't think anything could compare to what we did to come through with this pandemic.
It kind of reminded me of September 12th, 2001, where we saw this country really come together as one, and that's what our industry did during the pandemic, is we came together. There was no line in the sand. It wasn't management versus labor. It was the industry as one, and we made sure that not only the ports were moving, but we made sure that our members were working in a safe working environment.
I think that's when the country really recognized who we are and how important our jobs were. People take it for granted what we do, and a lot of people just don't know and don't understand that we move this commerce, and they buy the products off the ship and don't know how they got on the ship, you know, but they came on those ships.
It was a critical time to keep things moving. You know, you take for granted how things get on the shelves, but they got to come off those ships. Our ladies and guys were there to make sure that that happened.
It's incredible that we were able to keep things going like we did.
President Daggett worked with management to put safety protocols in place. PPE, temperature checks, and sanitizing stations.
In your day-to-day routine, you know, you're negotiating with these companies and you're always trying to get kind of the best thing for your membership. But it was really nice to see that through all that, there was never a negotiation about safety. It was just something that everybody, you know, everybody did. And I think we saved people's lives doing that.
Make no mistake, we lost ILA members. We lost family members. The ILA was not immune to this vicious virus that claimed millions of lives around the world. But just as patients looked to healthcare providers to be there for them, America looked to the ILA.
We have a responsibility to our country, and our members once again answered the call. It was more of a call of duty, in my opinion. And if we didn't go out there and do our job, this country would not move, the stores would not get their supplies, and more importantly, the hospitals wouldn't get their supplies. And it would have been a greater impact on this country if we didn't answer the call.
ILA is a force to be reckoned with.
We did answer the call. But as the country shut down, so did one of our key ILA sectors, the cruise ship industry. President Daggett knew those members would be hurting.
So me and my offices, with my son Dennis, we went to USMX and we said, we need a favor here for the people who work on the cruise ships. We need their benefits covered. And we did not get an argument. They sat down, they had a meeting, they came back and they said, President Daggett, we're willing to pay for the men who worked the year before, who put those hours in. For the guys that are out of work now with the pandemic, we want to cover them. That was a great thing for my membership.
President Daggett, that was a fantastic thing for him to do because, I mean, if anybody took a hit, the cruise industry did, because that's bringing people together, and we didn't want to bring people together during COVID, right? And you're talking thousands of people coming together. That's almost an impossible task during COVID when everybody's shutting down. So what he did to make sure everybody maintained their health care and everything was pretty amazing.
We saved a lot of guys' insurance and benefits. And by freezing their seniority, you know, we saved their pensions and everything.
President Daggett rose to a high level by taking that position. It's very common when people fall short of making their eligibility, they just accept that they don't have the coverage and they try to make up the following year. Without him inserting himself, it would have been a real travesty for many of our members.
And for the members who were able to keep working, we owe them a debt of gratitude.
It was very hard, but we got through it. And we kept the companies alive, and we kept commerce alive because of my membership. Because they got up and they went to work when people were not going into offices no more, working from home. My membership, men and women of the ILA, were out on those piers, day in and day out, 24/7. We never stopped. So my hat goes off to my membership, and the rest of the world should realize that it kept going. They don't realize when they sit home what the longshoremen are actually doing, keeping this country alive. And I'm so proud of them.
We are a force to be reckoned with.
Now that we're all back to work, what challenges and opportunities are on the horizon for our union?
Unfortunately, my generation and younger will be probably be fighting automation for the rest of our existence.
Everybody knows the word automation. Does everybody know what that means? That means less jobs.
I think we're the only union that really understands what automation can do to you. It can destroy you.
Automation is a verboten word. We do not believe in it, we do not support it, and we never will.
Harold takes a hard stand, and we're just not going to do it.
He's done an admirable job and gained respect around the world for taking that position on.
Not in my union, not on my watch. I'm never going to allow automation to come in, or semi-automation. It's just another back door of getting automation into the terminals. My people fought in the pandemic. My people suffered and died on these jobs on the waterfront, not to give it away to machinery to replace them. That's not going to happen in the ILA.
It was a fight that a lot of people thought we couldn't win. But he refused to accept that. And we proved, between the IDC and the ITF, we have done a joint study that, and there is no data out there that exists that proves that automation is more productive than an actual human being performing the job.
Till I die, I'm gonna fight it. I'm not gonna give up one job over automation.
A force to be reckoned with.
We are gonna be facing many challenges, but our top priority is to secure a master contract for our rank and file. And we're gonna make sure that we have ironclad language in the contract that protects us and protects our membership and preserves our work jurisdiction.
The last master contract we thought was one of the best of all time, and Harold says the next one's gonna be even better.
We haven't had a strike since 1977, and it was a 3-month strike, and I was involved in that strike. Don't let it go there. Because I'll tell you, if it goes down to the wire and I don't have a signed contract, at the time my contract ends, my union will be out in that street and we will not come back until I get everything I want in that contract. Those companies now are doing very, very good, making billions of dollars. God bless them. But you got to take us along and treat us good, because we're the ones that are making you make that money.
A force to be reckoned with.
We will have challenges in the years to come, but we'll also have opportunities. One of those opportunities will come in the form of loading ships to deliver offshore wind turbines. But like much of the work we do, it won't come easy or without a fight.
There's a lot of potential for work because almost every state, going from Maine down to Florida and then around and through the Panhandle into Texas and into New Orleans, is going to be touched by the offshore wind at some point in time.
That's another area that a couple of years ago, who would imagine it? Now all of a sudden it's popped up and it's going off gangbusters. There's a lot of work being created by this new industry, and we are doing our best to procure as much of that work as possible.
What we're doing is inserting ourselves and forcing that we're going to protect the ILA at core jurisdiction. So we're in that battle right now.
We're having some problems with the operational engineers, which we always seem to have a problem with. We seem to think that everything is theirs, but we have strict jurisdictional lines, and we'll stick to them. We'll fight for that work, and we will get it at the end of the day.
In the words of my dear friend and union brother, Bobby Alvera from the ILWU, the docks are ours. I mean, it's really that simple. The docks are ours. We don't go on construction sites trying to take over the building trades works, but when it comes to the waterfront, the docks are ours.
Yes, the docks are ours. We'll continue to stand with our brother and sister dock workers around the world.
When you start to meet with other unions throughout the world, you realize, wow, we all have the same problems. So in a world today where the powers to be are creating a lot of division, the dock worker movement is opposite of that. We are more unified than ever. I'm on my second term as the International Dock Worker Council General Coordinator, and it's a responsibility that I take very seriously. For the past 4 years, we've almost doubled our membership throughout the world, and I think the reason is because more dock worker unions are realizing the importance of global solidarity.
Solidarity. It's what got us where we are today. We stand together, brothers and sisters, and we welcome everyone who stands with us to be a member of our great union.
The ILA has been a huge supporter of civil rights for many, many years, and we continue to showcase to the public that our union will not stand for people of different race, color, religion being treated differently. We're all equal, we're all human beings, we're all one.
But I think the ILA as a whole is as diverse an organization as you'd ever want to see.
I'm old enough you know, about the civil rights in the 60s. I lived through that. And right now, the energy that we seen back then in the 60s, I feel it now. One particular thing I'd like to say is that we need everybody this November to come out and vote, not just for the president, for locally and everything else. That starts the ball rolling.
When we talk about civil rights, the first thing come to my mind is voters' rights. We support candidates that support civil rights and support voters' rights.
Let's make this thing happen. We're going to change this country, but make it fair and equal for everybody.
We need to keep this going peacefully and recognize that everybody is the same. No matter where you live, what color you are, we are the same.
Civil rights are also women's rights. And the ILA's Women on the Waterfront have changed our union for the better and are continuing to do that every day.
ILA women, we are a force to be reckoned with.
ILA women, a force to be reckoned with.
I'm really proud of the women of the ILA. I don't know if there was anybody more excited about the first annual ILA Women's Conference that was held in Jacksonville. It was the most electric meeting I ever went to. The energy was off the charts. Women are growing in this industry, and we want to make sure we provide a safe working environment for them. I couldn't be prouder of what the women are doing in this industry right now.
Any young lady can do it. If they put their mind to it, they can do it.
There's not one job on the waterfront that a woman can't do, in my opinion.
ILA women are forced to be reckoned with.
We see it daily. We see the numbers growing, something that we're proud of. Our women take a lot of pride in their union and in their industry. They're reliable, they're hard workers, and they're fierce.
A force to be reckoned with.
ILA women are without a doubt a force to be reckoned with.
And so, brothers and sisters, we gather here as we do every 4 years to show the world that we are a force to be reckoned with. And how are we going to show them?
Our solidarity. We are very strong together. We've never been stronger together. The bond is just so strong. So we know going forward that they can't break us.
We've got our work cut out for us. We've got to bring box counts up. We can't play politics with safety. You know, we've got to do the right thing, and we've got to do our part so that the boss can negotiate those types of agreements going forward and protect all of us. So we've all got a job to do.
The ILA is here. We're fighting for our men, and we will continue to fight for them, but we will also do what's right for this country.
I was hoping just the young guys would think about that and say that we're going to leave this thing in good hands for the next generation.
Right now, I believe our ILA family is more unified than ever. We've proven it time and time again. So if it's a fight they want, it's a fight they're going to get.
I know the structure of this union. I know it inside and out. And I will fight to the last breath that I can take to make sure that this union goes forward and keeps going the way that I think, and pass it on to all my members to think like me.
The ILA is a force to be reckoned with.
A force to be reckoned with.
The ILA is a force to be reckoned with.
A force to be reckoned with.
ILA is a force to be reckoned with.
Good video. Sisters and brothers, we are a force to be reckoned with. When I banged the gavel down, closing our 2019 International Convention, few could have predicted what we and the world were about to face less than 200 days later. In those early days of 2020, we began hearing news reports of a virus named Corona. Coronavirus, pandemic, masking, sanitizing, social distancing, isolation. These words and many other would become part of our daily vocabulary by the end of February 2020. And while the expression work from home was common around the country, that team and that term never became part of the ILA. Our brave heroes, called the ILA Longshore Workers, rose to the top as the nation steamily was crumbling to the bottom, as fear gripped the nation. Businesses closed in record numbers as our country and the world, filled with fear and panic, raced to the stores to scoop up life's basic needs. Toilet paper became the golden standard of 2020, but goods more important than toilet paper needed to be shipped and delivered, all handled by the ILA labor. Medical supplies for hospitals and clinics, food for our supermarkets, goods for our department store, construction material and steel and lumber for homes and office buildings. Ports remained open. Recall just how brave our longshoremen workers were in those early days of COVID. They were being asked to work ships manned by international crews who might be carrying the virus on board. All we knew back then was if you got COVID, you were likely going to die. Every family was impacted by this horrible virus, and our ILA family was no exception. Let's all rise as we view a scroll, active ILA longshore workers who lost, and we observe a moment of silence for them. Please be seated. We also honor those ILA pensioners and ILA family members we also lost, well as our management colleagues and their losses. The Daggett family suffered a brutal blow early in the pandemic, as my beautiful sister, Betty Jane, became one of its earliest victims. Betty Jane daughter, my niece, Mary Jane, who works at the International, is here, along with several of Betty Jane's grandchildren. Betty Jane was also Dennis Daggett's godmother. My chief of staff, Jim McNamara, lost his father-in-law in the early weeks to COVID, 92-year-old Herman Garakin. My best friend, Lewis Brown, I miss him. Name was on that scroll we just viewed. COVID took him from us as well. I still grieve his loss and my sister's. I know all of us carry the pain of a loss of loved ones from COVID. It was hell, and it was war. And our ILA workforce, truly American frontline heroes, I salute each of you and all the longshore workers we represent back in our home ports. When you return home after this convention, please tell our entire ILA family how proud we really are of them. The ILA is always happy to open our convention and seat our management colleagues. We're not sure they will enjoy everything we hear to say this morning, especially when I get into the subject of automation, jurisdiction, and our future contract negotiations. They will know clearly where the ILA stands. But we respect most of our employees and employee groups, led by the major one, the United States Maritime Alliance, USMX. Any review we make about how the ILA weathered the COVID challenges must include a salute to our management colleagues, led by Dave Adams, Paul DiMaria, and John Noddy, and our management leaders. Our convention site is sandwiched between two ILA's strongest and most successful cruise ports, Port Everglades to the north and Miami to the south. While containerized cargo and break bulk cargo continue to move through our ports in record numbers throughout COVID, the cruise industry completely shut down for almost 2 years. What a shame. You will see another video this morning that recaps how the ILA met the challenges of COVID and its impact on our cruise industry. Thousands of ILA members suddenly lost their livelihood. ILA locals were challenged to share work opportunities with a large pool. The threat that many of our ILA longshore workers would not meet their man hours threshold to receive MILA benefits because of the serious threat. My son Dennis and I met regularly with Dave Adams and Paul DiMaria, and the two sides worked out a solution that would protect the MILA benefits for all eligible ILA longshore workers. Thanks again, Dave and Paul, for doing that. We all appreciated it. Excuse me. Out of the many tragedies related to COVID pandemic, the ILA, the USMX, proved they could meet this unexpected challenge and offer a bright light to the ILA members and their families. The valor of the International Longshore Association and the bravery and its members deserve its place at the start of my remarks to you. And now to the business before us. Sisters and brothers, our 56th convention comes at a critical time for the ILA members. Dock workers around the globe are facing a major threat to their jobs and their future, the challenge brought by automation. It is a challenge that must be addressed and not ignored. The ILA and its members will never lose the battle against automation. We gather here this morning with a mighty collection of worldwide Docker Union leaders, demonstrating the power of global solidarity. Of all the duties I have performed as your international president this past year, perhaps the greatest was to reaffirm to my brothers, my friends, and the powerful leaders of the International Longshore and Warehouse Union, the ILWU, President Willie Adams, that we stand shoulder to shoulder with you in your negotiations, on the docks, in our hearts and soul. And now we know, that you signed an agreement with the Pacific Maritime Association. Sisters and brothers, dockers around the globe are a force to be reckoned with. We are all together in solidarity around the world. We will fight to keep automation of the maritime industry. Let's look at a short video that illustrates the deadly threat of automation. Run that clip, please.
All right, guys, get a gander of this view right here. Just an amazing, amazing view out here. Weather's beautiful this afternoon. Clouds have cleared up. Just gorgeous out here. So again, guys, if you guys can see that white K-rail right there, it goes up right there. All that over there is manual docks, UTRs. That's manual. You'll see men out in that area. This over here now, all of this, man, is all automated. All of that over there. It started with that little corner over there with a company called CUT. And they went out of business. And now Maersk has it over there. And they cleaned out this yard about 6 months ago and installed all automation here. Absolutely incredible. We lost about 600 jobs out here from this automation. So now I'm just curious to see what happens when it goes over to Hanjin over here, another big dock area, probably one of the, this is the biggest dock, and then Hanjin is probably second. But check those things out, man. No drivers in any of those machines, man. And they haul butt, man. Look at those things. They're no joke, man. And then over there is, well, they'll, they deliver them to the truckers over there. So the truckers will come all the way down this back road over here and go all the way to the back. And they'll be lined up all the way over here, just traveling all the way around, man, getting over here. I hear that Maersk is, they like coming to Maersk because they get their cans pretty quick. But again, guys, all automation. This is what happened. This is the future, not just of the waterfront, but this is the future for everyone. Autonomy, truck drivers, we're gonna be losing a lot of jobs to autonomy, guys. Not just on the waterfront, and AI is also gonna be taking over a lot of planning jobs, architecture jobs, logistic jobs. It's gonna be done in an instant by AI. So, this is the future right here, man. See that thing running through the stacks right there?
That was a video made by a guy up in the tower out in California, LA. I hope you got a good look at that. No trucks in there, no checkers, no longshoremen, no maintenance, all computerized. They say that's the future. Over my dead body. There is going to be an explosion throughout the world. If foreign-owned companies like Maersk and MSC try to replace our jobs with automation, they are going to get a painful reminder that longshoremen brought these companies to where they are today. Who the hell is a foreign company like Maersk to come to America, soil, and build a fully automated terminal like that one we just saw in this video? Merck takes over a great American company like Sealand and destroys the good-paying American jobs and values. Jobs lost in America and profits sent back to Copenhagen. This foreign company, Merck, tries to shove fully automated terminals down our throats. And for what reason? To eliminate good-paying American jobs. ILA jobs. And where is our government in all this? President Biden declares he wants to protect American companies, pay decent wages in America. How can this administration allow foreign companies like Merck and other foreign companies to get away with this? Mark my words, there's going to be an explosion, and the ILA and the dockers around the world are going to light the fuse. I don't care about lawyers and government. It's time to stop machines from taking our jobs, destroying our lives, and crippling the American economy. It's time we put companies out of business that push automation. Someone must take the bull by the horns, and that's me, and this will be worldwide. Worldwide. More and more. More and more, I feel strongly to form a global international maritime alliance, armed with the weapons to go on strike together and show foreign-owned companies like Merck and the world how powerful we are. This Dockers Global Alliance will have one major purpose: to combat automation and new technology. Every maritime union must be part of this alliance. We will be the first global alliance to take on companies that want to push automation on us. Companies like Merck and MSC, all dock workers from every nation will be involved with this global shutdown. And we will not work any company that wants to take our jobs away. We will unify and stronger than ever. Sisters and brothers, we must save the maritime unions of the world. And I believe this alliance can do just that. I'm talking about unions around the world, and we will target and strike any company who looks to push automation on us. I'm talking about China, Japan, Australia, Europe, America. All countries around the world will be part of this alliance. They are building ships that don't need maritime seamen aboard them. They have ships now. A container ship in Europe runs on batteries and no crew. That's the future. Let's get all the maritime seamen to join this alliance and let's all shut them down. Let's see how hot, let's see how the foreign companies own companies. Stop. Let's see how well foreign-owned companies like Merck do when global dock workers shut them down their operations from 3 months around the world. Shut them down for 3 months, put them out of business, because they're looking to put us out of business. Merck and other companies would not be this rich if it wasn't for the dockers around the world. We made them what they are, and they want to take our jobs away from us. The ILA. The ILA will lead the charge to make certain these foreign companies like Merck, no dockers can punch a powerful punch. You will see a force to be reckoned with. Don't underestimate us. Around the world at the same time, they want to eliminate our jobs. A global response for a global crisis. We are fighting for every future with automation. And we are running out of time to do something about it. Let's make July 24th Dock Workers' Declaration of Independence Day. Let's make, wake up America, wake up Canada, wake up Puerto Rico, wake up the Bahamas, wake up world. I have a message for Copenhagen. That's the home of MERS. Don't fuck with the maritime unions around the world. We will shut you down. We caution companies now that the ILA and other global dock worker unions deserve respect and great contracts for all we did to bring you the foreign companies to where you are today. And we know from our studies just how much money you companies have made in the last 5 years. Take a look at this video showing MSC adding 11 new giant ships to their fleet. To build those ships, it cost $1.8 billion just to contract the terminals to build them in South Korea. South Korea, because the labor is shit. Watch closely.
In South Korea, this elite team of marine engineers is embarking on an epic endeavor. They're attempting to build the biggest container ship in the world.
This ship is ruining it.
Stretching over 1,300 feet long and capable of carrying a colossal 23,000 shipping containers. They're pushing to complete this record-breaking vessel in just 12 months.
A lot of pressure, so we have to be careful.
To build this behemoth, the team must battle massive loads.
It's a disaster.
Terrifying heights. And punishing deadlines.
Production processes are more severe, more complex.
This ship ranks in a league of ambitious new engineering wonders that are bigger, faster, taller, and more advanced than anything ever constructed before. This is the inside story of the extraordinary challenge of building these giants. Every year, over 5,000 giant ships cross the world's oceans, stacked high with containers full of goods. These monster vessels transport everything from sports cars and computers to soft toys and refrigerated foods. Now, global shipping giant MSC is embarking on an ambitious $1.8 billion plan to build a brand new breed of super ship.
From design point of view, it's something very challenging.
At the company's headquarters in Sorrento, Italy, Giuseppe Gargiulo is in charge of overseeing the construction of this fleet of mammoth ships.
This will be the biggest vessel in the world because of the capacity.
There are very good reasons to build this revolutionary new mega fleet. Vessels will be cheaper and more efficient to operate.
It's important to have as much container on board because more container we carry, less will be the impact on the environment.
This is the colossal ship the team must build. Measuring over 1,300 feet in length, it is longer than an aircraft carrier. 55,000 tons of metal panel make up its hull. A single giant 34-foot wide propeller thrusts the ship forwards. This is powered by a three-story, 2,700-ton engine that produces a staggering 101,000 horsepower. A revolutionary stacking system supports containers over 100 feet high above the deck. It will transport 23,000 containers, the most ever carried by one ship.
This is a revolutionary and innovative ship.
This fleet will include 11 ships in total. The first of this new breed of megaship will be called the MSC Golson, meaning to smile. Finally, they bolt on 27 50-foot-high steel supports to hold up the ship's 13-high stack of containers. With these in place, the largest container ship the world has ever seen is ready to set sail. Work starts inside this cavernous 410,000 square foot workshop. The team build the ship piece by piece out of 300 enormous sections called blocks. To make these, their first challenge is to create vast 72 by 26 foot rectangular steel sheets. Overseeing the assembly is Jinman Kim. He starts with the largest steel sheets available.
This steel is 2 meter wide and 22 meter length.
But to make the side of the first giant block, they must weld 4 sheets together. To do this marathon job, Mr. Kim uses a robotic submerged arc welder. It operates 30 times faster than a human worker.
We are 100% automatic factory.
With the engine and propeller in position, the team faces one final major construction challenge. They must build the complex system of beams and supports that holds the containers in position. This megaship will hold a record-breaking 23,000 containers. Below deck, the ship will carry 9,788 in stacks, 12 high. But the real difference lies above deck. Here, super strong steel frames, called lashing bridges, span the hull. These have special fixtures called lashing rods to secure stacks of containers that soar 13 stories high. That's 2 stories taller than on most other container ships. In South Korea, workers race to build the world's biggest container ship. They've completed the hull and installed the propeller. Now, they must fit the lashing bridges that secure the containers to the ship. They tower 50 feet tall and are 200 feet wide. Chong's team welds the lashing bridge in place and secures it for the life of the vessel. In just under 12 months, the team has built the world's largest container ship. The MSC Golson sets off, bound for eastern China, where it will receive its first load of containers. Traveling more than 3 million miles over her lifespan, 10 more ships just like her will be delivered in the next year, carrying over 250,000 containers between them.
Imagine that guy in the video bragging his factory is 100% automated. Amen. That's what we're dealing with. You might as well see it and hear it. If that video doesn't make you realize an explosion's coming, I don't know what will. We will not take a back seat to anyone. It's time for foreign companies like Maersk and MSC to realize that you need us as much as we need you. You better keep that in mind as we start negotiations. You know, I will have more to say about this throughout the week. My convention team, compelled of amazing speakers program at this 56th convention. I look forward Wednesday when to hear from Willie Adams, as well as our international labor giants, Patty Crumlin and Jordi Ragunda. Well, feel the power of the international solidarity. With so many important topics to cover, issues central to you and me, I am challenged to fit everything into these open remarks. For example, I could further expand my discussion on automation, spend hours, even days on the subject to drive home the fact its devastating impact it has on our industry and workers, and why dockers around the world must remain united and fighting it all the way. We need to devote time to address negotiations with USMX. Our current 6-year agreement expires in 14 months. I hope to God that the companies are willing and serious to move on with this contract negotiations with the ILA. If it goes to the wire, I will guarantee there will be no extensions and we will be out in the street. Let me repeat that so we all know what may happen and how ILA intends to respond. If the ILA does not have a contract before October 1, 2024, we will be out in the street, no extensions. Don't come back and say we can't afford that kind of raise. One of your CEOs took a $4 billion bonus for himself at Christmas time. You can definitely afford it, and you know it. You made millions and billions of dollars in the last 5-6 years off the sweat of our backs around the world. And you know it. Let me explain something that happened with the last contract. We had clear wording in the agreement that any new terminal being built would be all ILA jobs. Before I signed the contract, I asked USMX attorney to explain that sentence to me and everyone in the room. You saw her signing the contract. He said, any new terminal will have to be all ILA. He said it twice. Everybody understood what he said in that room. Management and union. Then I signed the contract and everybody shook hands. When the new terminal in Charleston was built, the Letterman terminal opened, the Port Authority would not allow the ILA to have all the new jobs. USMX did not back us up on the contract. When USMX lawyer was asked by the labor board about his words, he said, I don't recall saying that. What a way to lie on the stand and not get arrested or perjure himself. I don't recall saying that. He said, he stood up and said it twice out loud in front of everybody. Everybody at the signing of that contract with USMX and ILA understood that part of the new agreement. And now, they don't want to honor the contract they signed. Now, I have lost faith and trust in USMX. You are not honorable. You know exactly what I'm talking about. The ILA will always honor what we say, and we expect USMX to do the same. A growing critical important subject area we must address at this convention is the wind projects that are now being constructed at ports around the world. Here again, the ILA and its worldwide dockers family must remain united and strong, resolving the safeguard of our jurisdiction and beat the crap out of anyone who looks to challenge our jurisdiction when it comes to wind projects. We had the first test within the past several weeks in New Bedford, Massachusetts, and New London, Connecticut. So, to get to this business of the convention sooner, and to hear from today's speakers, we will dedicate time during each of our convention sessions this week to expand on these and other important subjects. We will suggest the course that the ILA should take to achieve our goals. Sisters and brothers delegates, I was a young U.S. Navy veteran of Vietnam War returning home from action in 1967 to bring my journey with the ILA, start my journey with the ILA. Like many of you, I followed in the footsteps of my father and my grandfather to the ILA waterfront. I came to the ILA the year Teddy Gleason, our great ILA president for 24 years, and my mentor was about to begin his second term as an international president. Blessed with strong family connections between the Gleasons and the Daggetts, I enjoyed a front row seat watching Teddy Gleason take on the challenging threats of his time, containerization. I am happy a few of those folks I met at the start of my ILA career were still here. It was when I returned home from the service that I first met Tony Socia, who was a young Sealand executive fresh off the campus of Seton Hall University. We became fast friends, and I was honored last fall to be awarded the AOTUS Award and have him presented to me by Tony Socia. Our friendship extends more than a half a century. It was never the case of him being the Sealand management guy and me being ILA labor. Tony and so many other young Sealand service executives like Brian Dugan, Jack Kelly, Captain Clark, Paul Richardson, Jerry Toomey, Frank Katina, Cecil Yeagers, Clara McLean. These were men and women dedicated to their company and worked hard to build relationships with the ILA. Great names from a management ILA shredded past. We all knew we had a job to do and working together as friends and colleagues. We did the job pretty damn well. That's why it's disturbing to see the track record of the companies that replaced Sealand foreign-owned Maersk, that put profits again over people. In reflecting on our past, I hope that the spirit and the mutual respect between labor and management is carried from those early days in 1967 and becomes part of our modern day fabric in 2023. I look out this morning at the present day ILA membership, happy to witness it is more diverse with more women, and I'm feeling the confidence of the bright future for you and the ILA. The feeling I had stepping on the docks when I was a rookie longshore worker in 1967. Yes, this morning I exposed real threats to ILA workers with automation and jurisdiction. But I look out and see a growing, healthy ILA ready to meet those challenges. I feel a surge of confidence for the ILA's future, now strengthened by the international solidarity with dockers around the globe, all committed and ready to stand together. I look with parental pride at my two sons, Dennis and John, and my daughter, Lisa, so proud they're following my footsteps and are making their mark in the ILA. In total, the Daggett family now claims five generations working on the ILA waterfront, spanning more than a century. Hell, my family alone is a force to be reckoned with. As I complete my third term, yes. As I complete my third term as your international president, I look to my left and right and thank my international executive officers for their support and for helping me carry on the missions of the ILA to serve and protect every one of our members. Challenges remain, global still to be attended, and jobs to continue. So I proudly stand before you, my beloved sisters and brothers of the ILA, and announce that I will seek your support on Thursday for another term as your international president. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. May God bless you, your families. May God bless our ILA. God bless America, Canada, Puerto Rico, and now the Bahamas. Thank you, sisters and brothers, as I bang this gavel down with a force to be reckoned with, I simply say, let's get to work.